Hello and a very warm welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching The Big Picture with me, Frank Rausen Pereira. Well, the government's economic reforms agenda in response to the coronavirus pandemic has the potential to raise India's medium-term growth rate. Ratings agencies expect the centre to announce more reforms measures over the next few months and years and hope that state governments will follow suit. Fitch Ratings recently said several initiatives such as the agricultural reforms to offer farmers more flexibility to sell their produce, labour reforms to improve access to social security passed by Parliament amid the COVID crisis may lift prospects of medium-term growth. Meanwhile, amid the farmers' protests, the chief economic advisor on Tuesday said that the country's new farm reforms are designed to benefit the majority of the agricultural sector. The finance minister, Nirmala Sitharaman, too, assured the industry that momentum of economic reforms will continue to make India a hotspot of global investment. India has turned the crisis created by the COVID-19 pandemic into an opportunity to push the economic reforms, which remain pending for decades, she said, while addressing the National MNCs Conference 2020 organized by the industry chamber CII. In this edition of The Big Picture, we will analyze the need for economic reforms. Joining me on the program today are Dr. Arvind Virmani, Chairman, EGRO Foundation and former Chief Economic Advisor to the Government of India, and Gurcharan Das, best-selling author and economist. Thank you to my guests for joining me on this edition of The Big Picture. Mr. Das, let me begin the program with you. Let's first try and understand and analyze how important economic reforms are, especially in the midst of the global recession and in the midst of this particular pandemic.
Well, it is the only way to lift the income of Indians, and the reforms is a proven way that country after country has been able to raise its growth rate, and there are still a number of reforms that need to be done after these excellent labor and agriculture, and before that, education policy that was announced. All these reforms will add up to make India a high growth country. Now, if you ask me, you can take the example of the farm reforms, or you want to come back to that?
No, you can take the example of the farm reforms. Let's start with that. Yeah.
Yes. So these three reforms that have been announced really represent azadi, freedom for the farmers. It's the most important step that has been taken by any government since the Green Revolution in 1960s. And it will lead to a second Green Revolution. And the main need, the main thing it will achieve will be higher productivity. Now, India's productivity is lower, agricultural productivity is lower than our competitive countries. One of the reasons is that our farm holdings are small and the farmer cannot make the investment to raise the productivity. For example, in China's productivity, China has half the arable land of India, but it produces double the crop of India. So you can see that there is its productivity is three times higher than India's. So the reforms in different ways will help us make the nation more productive. And it also is the farm protests that are taking place now show you that it is difficult. Reforming in a democracy is not easy. The reason is that politics is a short-term game, you know, a 2020 match. Economics is a long-term game, a five-day test match. So this is why reformers find it difficult to execute the reforms. For example, if a populist leader promises 1 rupee rice to the people, well, he always wins. The reformer will say that I will create the conditions for investment. Investment will come, productivity will grow, supply will grow, price will fall, and the price of rice will come down. Hmm. The protests are coming from a small section of the farming community. That is the section 6% only get the benefit of the minimum support price.
Right.
Rich these are rich farmers. They are mostly in Punjab. So you have a small farmers, these farmers are rich, and they are supported financially by the Artiyas, who are the commission agents in the APMC mandis. That's why the APMC name you keep hearing. Hmm. These Artiyas, commission agents, earn 1,500 to 3,000 crores per year across the country.
Sure.
So they are financing these protests. And so a small group of protesters are making it seem like this is a national issue. And it's very easy for, you know, to understand that how they will lose out, because they are the only people, frankly, because the farmer is being given choice.
Mr. Das, let me take the points that you're making forward with Mr. Virmani as well, who's been listening in patiently on the discussion so far. So, Dr. Virmani, you know, since we are here, let's discuss this particular aspect as well. Can populism and reforms go hand in hand?
I would like to put it in perspective. You know, we've gone too quickly into specific reforms, but there's a whole set of reforms which, you know, there was a dry period. So people have got to, a lot of people in the world are thinking that the Modi government was anti-reform. Well, even if we set aside the GST and the code, the bankruptcy code, you know, the reforms really start restarted or got going in September of 2019 with the corporate tax. And then there's been a whole entry of opening up of government monopolies. Now, just to repeat what Gurcharan said, that the importance of reforms, and as you asked, is that it will increase productivity and competitiveness, which in turn increases the rate of vote of per capita income, which is critical to the rise of welfare of the people. You know, as a summary measure, we keep talking about GDP growth, but the ultimate objective is welfare. And the method is to create competition, which raises productivity and competitiveness. So just very quickly, you know, government monopolies in coal, oil, defense, space, atomic energy have since been gone. The strategic industry policy framework, which was announced, hopefully it will be fleshed out, which will allow more sustained privatization of losing companies, which are a big drag on the economy. I mean, people don't realize how much money we waste on these public sector units. Gurcharan has already mentioned education, agriculture, labor codes. There was a report that they are following these laws into rules and procedures. You know, this is all very hard work. It's easy to think when it happens, oh, the law has been changed. They have to do the law, the Electricity Amendment Act, which is being modified. Now, all these actions have been, you know, have started, and there are a number of them in the works, which I'm sure will happen and which we can come back to discuss. But in this context, there are certain, you know, some of these have not attracted a lot of attention. But why has the agricultural reforms attracted attention? So the key to reforms, you know, I was involved in all the 90s and 2000s reforms. The key is the timing and phasing. I think one of the mistakes which Modi government has made is to do it in a huge spurt. You know, there are these three agricultural laws, just to take that example. They could have been done over the, you know, over a longer period of time, 1, 2, 3. All at once, you do everything. So all the potential, you know, even though the vested interest may be small amounts, they all congregate at the same time. So I think the timing and phasing reforms has not been very good. And the timing and phasing is very important for your question. You know, of vested interests will always oppose reforms. But if they are isolated, if there's, you know, if the reforms had been kind of done in parts, and particularly the critical ones, And if you recall, the land reforms were done right in the beginning of Modi, but then they had to backtrack because the phasing and timing was not, and the public education, perhaps, I agree with Gurcharan on that some of these laws, not all of them, for example, really, like I said, the monopolies of coal, etc., have been broken. They are not big. They don't impact or seriously affect directly too many public interests which can protest. They are basically monopolies of the public sector and so on. So it all depends on the type of reforms, the kind of reforms, etc. And some of them need to be much more carefully managed.
Right.
Not all of them.
Okay. Points taken. So yes, Mr. Das, go ahead. You wanted to make a point.
Yeah. No, I wanted to continue what Arvind is saying, that it is not just the Modi government that did not sell the reforms. This is a fault right from 1991 onwards. The reality is that all the reforms that were done, wonderful reforms that were done from 1991 and slowly onwards, whether it was there in whichever government, there were reforms done in the Devegowda government, Vajpayee government did a lot of reform. The problem is that none of the reformers, Manmohan Singh, Chidambaram, Vajpayee, even Shori, they didn't go out and sell the reforms the way that you've got to. That's why India has reformed by stealth at night. Chupke, chupke, chori, chori. Now, that is not the way to do it. You have to make people understand that reforms are good for everybody. Today, people cannot distinguish between being pro-market and pro-business. Pro-market means reform, and pro-market results in competition. Competition lowers the costs of products. It raises the quality of products and helps everybody. We have seen that in the cell phone case, in cable TV, in civil aviation, in sector after sector that we have reformed. Now, the people think that reforms make the rich richer and the poor poorer. So it's exactly the opposite that is true. And the trouble is the opposition party says exactly the opposite to what they try to do when they are in government. So this is a bit of the tragedy of democracy, that the same political party will be against the reform. All the political parties today who are protesting, whether it's Sharad Pawar or Rahul Gandhi or everybody, has been behind these reforms at some point or the other. And it is fad. Anyway, let's come back to these reforms, because this is truly an Azadi. It will create a second green revolution. And I was explaining to you how the fact that, how, for example, the first reform, which is to give farmer the freedom. Today, the farmer is at the mercy of one mandi, APMC, government-regulated mandi, which is a monopoly buyer. And what the arathiyas and the wholesalers do at the mandi is they fix a very low price and they don't declare it until the evening. So the poor farmer is waiting all day. He has to go back home at night, and then he makes a distress sale. That is the terrible thing of this system. Now the farmer has freedom. He can buy in another mandi, whether it's a private mandi. In fact, Ramesh Chand of NIT and Niti Aayog has made a very good suggestion that they should make an equal, that today states are earning more taxes from the APMC mandis. They should equalize, whether it's a private mandi, one mandi, make it 1% tax for everybody. Then the farmer has a choice. And so just take an example that a farm, you and I pay 40 rupees, say, for a kilo of aloo. Mm. And the farmer gets only 10 rupees. That 30 rupees in between goes to the arathiya, the wholesaler, the retailer, the rediwala, this whole chain eats up that rest.
Right.
If you allow the farmer direct purchases, you'll shorten the chain. And so the farmer could go up to 15 rupees, the price to the consumer could come down to 30 rupees if you had that. Because you reduce some of the middleman's profit. And so the second benefit of this reform is the removal of the Essential Commodities Act. Now, Essential Commodities Act used to put a limit on stocking of, say, the potatoes. It was considered an essential commodity, and they didn't want the price to go up, so a trader could only keep so much. This is why cold storages did not come up, because cold storages depend on stocking.
Right.
And now, with cold storages coming up, because the stocking is permitted, the farmer has an additional. He can sell directly to the cold storage. Mm. He can sell directly to the food processor. So there are many avenues that are given. So why is the farmer protesting? He's like a prisoner. Jo chidiya pinjre mein hoti hai na, a parrot which is in a bird cage, it loses the ability to fly. That's what's happened to the farmer who has been under this heavy, heavy regulation.
Right.
He can't. वो चिड़िया उड़ नहीं सकती, उनको आजादी नहीं समझ आती, क्या आजादी होगी उनकी जिंदगी में.
Right.
So my point is, say the other objection that these people have today, the farmers have, कि MPA जो minimum support price है, MSP, this should be put into the law.
Right.
Now, how can you put a price in the law? And secondly, this MSP system is a second-rate system. Because what happens in the MSP, you know, we may want to change it. We may want to one day remove all subsidies and give farmer cash transfers through the DBT, which is a much better thing because it doesn't spoil the whole economy. But now MSP, what it does, the farmer, the government is forced to buy what people don't want. Every year,
right,
mountain of grain comes up in our FCI warehouses, and some of it is eaten by rats.
Okay, points
and
taken.
You don't produce what you want. You want farmers to produce pulses, protein-rich dal.
Right. Mr. Das, points taken. We've got paucity of time. Let me bring in the other panelists as well so that we can discuss a few more aspects too. We've got about 7 minutes left on the program. So, Dr. Virmani, moving forward now from the, farm sector reforms, talking about some other aspects as well, the government is now keen on spending to ensure that the right kind of impetus is given as far as the economy is concerned. The finance minister has very categorically stated that reforms have already been undertaken. So more spending is going to be seen as far as the government is concerned, so as to ensure that we see the right kind of results from these reforms. Now, is that also likely to have an impact on the fiscal deficit, and is that a cause for concern?
I think you should have had a separate discussion on agricultural reforms and expenditures. You're not really discussing the whole slew of reforms. I don't know. I would like to speak about the budget and the reforms which are possible there instead of going to a third topic, because we spent the most of the time on agricultural reform. So I think the key, the budget is about 6 weeks away or thereabouts. There are three important reforms which can be introduced into the budget. One, of course, is the direct tax code, which has been pending. There was a committee more than a year ago, which gave a report to the finance ministry. I really do hope that the finance ministry will look carefully at it and really introduce, this is the chance, simplify, rationalize that reform has been pending for, again, for something like 11 years. I mean, the last report which I approved myself as CEA was in 2009. And when it happens, again, we will see this charade of people saying this stuff has not been discussed, which is a really incredible thing, frankly. The second one, of course, is the GST, which requires the GST Council to approve. But I think what I hope that the Union Finance Minister can do as an important member of the GST Council is lay out her own approach to simplifying, rationalizing, because both these reforms are critical to the MSME sector. You know, the corporate tax I mentioned reform happened in September, but if we really want to broaden it, these two reforms are very important for the smaller people. And the third one is direct cash transfer system. It's not just a question of just a substitute for, farm subsidies, but a whole structure of subsidies is badly distorting. You know, to take the other example of fertilizer, which encourages pollution of the water. So not only is water being depleted by this rice, wheat, sugar economy, but it's also being polluted heavily because we subsidize artificial fertilizer. You'd be surprised to learn that I heard recently a farmer from Punjab only who is growing organic thing and exporting to the world, all over India and the world. So one of the important elements, just to as an aside on the previous issue, is that innovation, new product marketing is very, very, will get a boost from these three things. And finally, as I said, the direct tax cash transfer system to, there are middlemen and vested interest even than that, even more corruption and vested interest. And so to combine subsidies to the extent feasible, of course, this is one of those sensitive politically sensitive matters, which would have to be done careful and with an amount of education. Some kind of an announcement of doing this over a period of time, perhaps the next year, would, I think, be an important element of the budget. As far as your fiscal question is concerned, I think that's the least important for this current year, the pandemic year, the year of lockdown. I think the key thing is, where is the money needed? How much money is needed? And to focus it there. It doesn't matter whether it's 10 crore, whether it's 100 crore, that is a secondary issue in my view. And of course, the final fourth thing is that the lockdown affected not just private expenditures, but government government projects and programs also had to be slowed down. They slowed down. So I think the reactivation of these infrastructure spending, et cetera, is very important and will require attention, kind of direct attention of the government.
Okay, time now to get quick closing comments from both my panelists with the best way forward. I've got 2 minutes left on the program, so I'm going to ask my panelists to be brief in 1 minute each. The best way forward, starting first with you, Mr. Das.
Well, Arvind has laid out a very good list of reforms that can come with the budget. I think, yes, you could add the big other reform is electricity. That in electricity distribution, we have a serious problem for the country. And the other area is still the problem of cleanup of the financial, the twin balance sheet problem was there and it's still not cleaned up.
Okay.
Absolutely.
So let me just add a few.
Yes. Yeah. Go ahead. Close the show for us with the concluding remarks.
Yeah. The three important ones I told you, but there are a couple of other things which also come within the purview of the finance ministry, looking forward to the budget. One is skills. You know, we have this Atmanirbhar Bharat, the PLI scheme, etc. To make these more successful, you also got to do, because much of manufacturing, the learning by doing is very important. So generation of skills must go hand in hand. So the Apprenticeship Act, for example, is one of the things which needs to be amended to make that possible. Secondly, the tariffs, we really haven't looked in a rational way. Of course, people have complained. There are now new books saying that how these tariff increases have taken place. But I think you need a rationalization. I don't think that there is an impression that it's been somewhat ad hoc. You know, but we need a rational system which is connected to Atmanirbhar and the PLI scheme and is very focused. You know, this kind of general scattershot approach to, you know, the tariffs is not a good one. And finally, EODB, the regulations, you know, of course, 60% of regulatory system or even more is in the states, but at least what is in the purview of the central government, you know, people have talked about digitization, post-file audit, etc. Just simplifying the whole regulatory system. I think, again, you can't do it in one go, but I hope the central government will make some indication of a more comprehensive type of approach to this.
Okay. All right. On that note, then I'll have to call it a wrap on this edition of The Big Picture. Thank you to my panelists for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. Well, that's it from me. See you again next time.